Namaste, people. Welcome to Shweta's Basket. My name is Shweta, and this is my basket, which are very lovingly packed with goodies like short stories, poems, book, movie, and restaurant reviews, all absolutely fresh and original. For the reviews, you can head over to my website, www.shwetasbasket.com. And for stories and poems, stick around. Where should we party? Sometimes, finding the right venue is the biggest issue, isn't it? A new place, a new experience, that's what we crave for, right? You know how it is. Somebody will say, let's go to that place, and we say, nah, that's too boring. And then someone will suggest another place, and we'll say, nope, done and dusted, we are not going there again. So, we're always looking for something new and something exciting. But you know, it's not just us who's looking for something new. There is someone else looking for a new destination to party. Want to know who it is? And whether they find their perfect venue? Then lend me your ears. For here's my story titled, A Celestial Soiree. It had to be perfect. After all, it was not every day that they got an opportunity to party till the wee hours of the night. Managing an enormous enterprise took up all their time. Millions of people depended on them. Whilst most looked up to them in gratitude, there were some ungrateful people too. But not looking after them just because they were ungrateful was not the way they operated. Who are they, you ask? Well, they are none other than the triumvirate of the Hindu religion, Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva. The business of managing this crazy world kept them very busy. Their better halves were equally devoted to their tasks. The get-together was once in a blue moon affair, and hence imperative that it be perfect. And this was the topic of discussion. I want a beach party. I want to feel the sand under my toes, a zephyr on my face. I live on Kailash Mountain and I'm tired of the cold, said Shiv, as his brows creased and he splayed out his hand to point out the snow-covered mountains. At the rate the temperatures were dipping due to pollution and global warming, Shiv was sure that his fingers would soon match the blue color of his throat. Standing next to him, Nandi nodded in agreement. He too was ready for a party anywhere other than Kailash. Huh? Absolutely not. I live in the ocean and I'm tired of all things wet. No sandy beaches or gently lapping waves, said an agitated Vishnu. It seemed the more agitated Vishnu got, faster the Sudarshan Chakra spun on his forefinger. He continued, I want to go to a mountain retreat and party. I want to breathe in the cool, crisp mountain air, Vishnu said, inhaling deeply. Just like this. Then, still staring at Shiv, he exhaled it slowly. Feet firmly planted with their hands on their hips, both gods glared at each other. They were a sight to behold. One, bedecked in the most luxuriant yellow and green cloth a god could own, and the other, bare-chested and magnificent with only a tiger skin to cover him. Poor Brahma was literally caught between them. His head kept swiveling back and forth as the argument continued. What could he possibly do? The memory of that one time when he had tried to assert his superiority over Vishnu was still fresh in his mind. What a disaster that had been, he thought, as he shook his head. Shiv's turning into the fire pillar, the lie in which he, Brahma, the creator of this universe, had robed in the innocent Ketki flower, Shiv's tremendous anger at this deception and the resultant curse. Brahma shuddered. He had paid a very heavy price for it. Still, he tried. Perhaps we can go to... He trailed off as he realized that neither of them was paying any attention to him. He cleared his throat and tried again. maybe we can go to places like Ibiza, Amsterdam, or even Las Vegas, he said wistfully. A whimsical smile spread across his face at the thought of partying in these cities and enjoying the various attractions they had to offer. At that precise moment, Devi Parvati and Devi Lakshmi popped in, as if they had been eavesdropping on the conversation and waiting for the right moment to jump in and offer their advice. "No, absolutely not. I am not going to those places. One is no better than the other," asserted Parvati. Wearing a deep red-colored sari with the long tresses adorned with jasmine flowers, she looked resplendent. "Yes," agreed Lakshmi, who was wrapped in a bright pink sari and bedecked with gold jewelry from head to toe. "Moreover, these are all earthly places with earthly experiences. I don't want mountain or ocean or cities," she said, as she pursed her lips and looked at each god in turn. "I want something truly exceptional." Parvati nodded emphatically, sending her earrings jingling. This effectively shot down the three ideas and resulted in three hung faces. Apparently, being chastised by your wife is not just a mortal affliction. Just then, astride her majestic white swan arrived Devi Saraswati. As she dismounted, Brahma rushed forward to offer her a hand. Clad in a white sari and holding a customary book in one hand and a rosary in the other, she alighted. Her countenance shone with the brilliance of knowledge. With a gentle demeanor and her serene smile, she looked regal. In a dulcet voice, she said, "I second what Lakshmi has said. The venue has to be extraordinary, neither earthly nor heavenly." She looked around and asked, "Any ideas?" Well, that was all the encouragement the others needed to get into an argument again. Amidst all the bickering came Devlok's live correspondent Narad. "Narayana, Narayana, my lords and ladies, please desist from this squabbling. It is causing mild tremors on earth and people are fearing earthquakes and tsunamis. What's wrong, my lords? Tell me and I shall strive to solve it," he offered, clicking his kartals. Shiva said, "Narad, all of us want to party and we want it to be unforgettable. You know, we rarely get an opportunity to do this." He then went on to explain the whole situation. After listening carefully, Narad said, "That's it. That's the entire problem, my lord." "Don't worry, I will take care of it." Then saying, "Narayan, Narayan," he vanished. Narad went to Vishwakarma, the divine architect, and said, "You are to bring your considerable experience and expertise to design this venue. It has to be something which has never been seen before. It cannot be earthly or heavenly. And the lighting and decoration has to be truly spectacular." Considering the enormity of the task, both dedicated themselves to it immediately. On the day of the party, Vishnu summoned Narad and said, "So Narad, where's the party tonight?" Narad smiled. With a twinkle in his eyes, he gave a cryptic reply. "Just follow the lights, my lord. They will lead you to the venue." So, at the appointed hour, the three couples, accompanied by the eclectic entourage, prepared to follow the light. Narad and Vishwakarma had outdone themselves. True to his word, Narad presented the gods with a celestial soiree like none other. Magical and mystical, it was a place neither on earth nor in heaven. It was somewhere in between. And those lights that the duo had struck gave the place a truly ethereal feel. The gods were awed. Once they finished marveling at the beauty of the venue, they got down to the business of enjoying the party. Seeing them all settled in and enjoying themselves, Narad made to leave. Vishnu called out to him, "Narad, wait!" Narad turned around, his face adorned with a mischievous smile, for he knew what was coming. "What are these undulating and pulsating lights?" Vishnu asked, enthralled. as he gazed at the hues of green, pink, violet and blue as they lit up the northern sky. Do they have a name? Nara tilted his head and said, Aurora Borealis, my lord. Aurora Borealis. So, the next time you watch the Aurora Borealis, look closely. You never know who you might glimpse. For it is rumored that the venue is visited by other gods too. After all, who wouldn't be in need of a break when they manage this crazy gone to dogs world, right? That was my story with a bit of mythology and a bit of geography mixed in. Hope you enjoyed it as much as the gods enjoyed the party and I enjoyed penning it and narrating it. And if you ever happen to be in the northernest part of the northern hemisphere during the Aurora Borealis, look closely and let me know who you saw. You can write to me. My email ID is shweta@shwetasbasket.com and you'll find that in the episode description as well. Well guys, that brings me to the end of this episode. Please visit my website shwetasbasket.com for more such short stories, poems and reviews. And apart from emailing me, you can get in touch with me on Facebook and Instagram. My handle is shwetasbasket. I hope you got my previous episodes, and not to miss any in the future, do subscribe, follow my podcast. And guys, before I leave, just want to ask you a question. Have you ever thought or wanted of having a website of your own? If yes, then listen on. In the meantime, this is your host, Shweta Singh, signing off. Till we meet again on the air. Bye for now. Do you want to have a website of your own? Are you a writer, photographer, actor, makeup artist, hairstylist, or even a tutor, singer, painter, journalist, consultant? Or do you have your own cafe, restaurant, resort, holiday home, shop, small business, hospital, or even a blog, WordPress, or Blogspot account that you want to migrate to a good-looking website? Well, look no further. The geeks will help you, and you will find them in the Geeks Room at Artunzen. Just click on the link in the episode description. Yes, it's that simple to have a website. My website is hosted and managed by them. And want to know what I love about them? They are professional, customer pleasers, straight talkers, and very competently priced. So what are you waiting for? Your website is just a